Now, part one of Westwood by Stella Gibbons. In 1943, bomb hit London. A young teacher called Margaret Steggles meets a wealthy family, the Challises, who live at Westwood, an elegant house in Highgate in London. They have great charm, and with the casual selfishness of the privileged, soon take advantage of Margaret's slavish admiration.
Episode 1 of Westwood by Stella Gibbons, adapted for radio by Lynne Truss, with Juliet Aubrey as Margaret Steggles, Michael Fenton-Stevens as Gerard Challis, and Saffron Burrows as Hilda Wilson. Westwood is narrated by Rosemary Leach.
London was beautiful that summer of 1943. The ruins of the small, shapely houses in the older parts of the city were yellow, like the sunlit houses of Genoa. During those months of calm, London in ruin was beautiful as a city in a dream. Then the autumn came with mists. On Hampstead Heath, the young willow trees on either side of a long hilly road did not turn until late October, so they were still in their long full leaf one foggy September afternoon around sunset when a thin young woman of medium height named Margaret Steggles arrived outside Kenwood House, where she was to meet her friend Hilda.
Season of mists and mellow fruitfulness.
It was unfair that a young woman of such refined appreciation of nature, not to mention such a strenuous love of romantic poetry, was cursed with the name of Steggles. But life is not fair, and between you and me, it wouldn't be worth writing novels about if it were.
Close bosom friend of the maturing sun. Conspiring with him how to load...
Well, you're a nice one.
Well, Hilda... I didn't see you.
Mark, I've been waiting ages. Look at the time.
I'm sorry. But isn't it beautiful here? With the trees and the mist and the setting sun?
If you say so. The point is, Mark, we'll be lucky to see that house now before dark. And I don't suppose it's got any blackout. Oh, give us a kiss then. What have you been doing with yourself all afternoon?
Hilda and Margaret had been at school together. They were friends, but had little in common.
I went to the concert at the National Gallery, and then I walked about on the heath.
Hilda now worked at the food office and went to British restaurants with Rear Gunners. Margaret was a schoolteacher, given to reciting Keats at rather obvious moments. Hilda was very pretty, and always managed to have nice shoes. Margaret was not, and didn't.
I was thinking of going to see that play, Mountain Air, again later. Would you like to come, Hilda?
To a play? You are dopey. Oh. Is your torch all right? Mine needs fixing. I've been meaning to tell Dad for days.
I hope the house is suitable, Hilda. I'd like some good news for Mother after looking all week.
I shall indeed. Oh. Shh. What? Why?
Shh. Two tall men were walking towards them in the dusk. The elder, with a strikingly intellectual profile, wore a closely fitting dark coat and diplomatic hat. The younger wore looser clothes and a black sweater with a turtleneck.
Yes, I do understand that, but nevertheless...
They were wrapped in conversation on a question of aesthetics.
Yes, but here's my point. Renoir was painting all through the Franco-Prussian War, and people didn't call him Pollyanna, did they?
Well, no, I believe not. All the same, Alexander. Give me the darkness of the flesh or full light of the spirit.
Yes, yes, all right. But I just don't see that it's my duty to depict pain and suffering just because there is...
And so the unknown men passed by, and the life of the impressionable Margaret Steggles was changed forever. Or at least, it was changed in quite interesting and instructive ways for the 12-month period of the ensuing narrative.
What's up? Do you know them?
No, but I've heard someone say that before.
What?
That thing about the darkness of the flesh.
It was in that play I saw, Mountain Air. That gentleman must have seen it too.
Can we get on then?
Oh, look, they've dropped something. It's a ration book. Oh, Hilda, imagine being so careless with a ration book.
Where did they go?
Search me. But it'll have a name and address in it here. Hebe Nyland. Lamb Cottage, Romney Square, Hampstead NW3. You can pop it in the post later, Mutt. They'll hardly know they've lost it.
Hebe Nyland. Wow. Yes. Quite a different kettle of fish from Margaret Steggles.
Yes, dear.
Jenny, oh, good, it is you.
Well, I am naked on the floor of our bathroom, Serafina. Who did you think it was?
I thought it was probably you.
At Westwood, his large house in Highgate, the playwright Gerard Challis had been practising yoga since returning from his walk on Hampstead Heath. Yes. The reason the dark stranger at Kenwood House had quoted the line, "Give me the darkness of the flesh, or full light of the spirit," was not that he had seen the play Margaret Steggles referred to, but that he had written it.
I was thinking, I think I'll drop by the theatre later. What?
Would you like your dressing gown?
Oh, yes, if you like.
Oh, that's better. Your skin is so dazzlingly white, darling. I was beginning to get a headache. Hand me that brush, dear. Now, sit here. How's the new play going? You did tell me. Isn't it about an Austrian tart?
I prefer whore, Serafina.
Do you? Well, I suppose you know best. It's just that it all sounds awfully funny peculiar. Could you do my zip? Mm.
Funny peculiar?
Yes. But then they all sound a bit funny peculiar at first, don't they, all plays? Oh, you know, six women botanists and a male guide isolated in a snowstorm on the Andes.
Mountain Air is in its 25th week, my dear.
Precisely my point. Who would imagine? Then there was the one with seven men and one female nurse on the Tsetse Fly Research Station.
I don't quite see why you have to try and...
And now this poor Austrian tart bandied about by eight male officers of a crack regiment in Vienna.
As his wife was so vividly establishing, Gerard Challis was forever thinking up new dramatic permutations as settings for his oracular wisdom.
Well, I'm getting down. Oh... Tell me how that dark flesh thing goes again.
Give me the darkness of the flesh or full light of the spirit.
I don't know why, Jerry, but I can never get that to stick in my head for 5 minutes.
Is this it? Shine the torch, then. Yes. Number 17. Well, still got a gate. That's something. Got the key. Here. Oh, there's a gorgeous moon. Look.
Whatever's all that muck on the floor? Where? Oh, Mark, watch out. I think the ceiling's down. Isn't it wicked, ruining people's houses like this?
Oh, Hilda, there's plaster everywhere.
Never mind, ducks. You're always saying you haven't suffered enough. Now you'll be able to have plaster every day in your powdered egg.
Oh, look, there's French windows. And a little garden for Dad to dig. I think it's quite a nice house. It's definitely the best I've seen all week.
Let's go upstairs.
All right. Watch yourself.
Thank you.
It looks like there's one for your mother and father. And one for you. And a spare room.
Mother and Dad have separate rooms. And we shan't be having anyone to stay.
Yes, well, people can be ever so fond of each other, even if they do have separate rooms. My Auntie Grace and Uncle Jim do, and they're quite a pair of lovebirds.
Oh, there's a lovely house you can see from here, look. With gates. Do you know it?
Oh, yes. That's called Westwood. They're always having parties. Very la-di-da. Come to think of it, we ought to have a party when you move in. Oh, listen.
Oh, no.
And there isn't time to run back to Mum now. She'll be having fits, poor thing. Under the stairs.
Under the stairs.
Mind your head, Mutt.
There's not much room, is there?
You're telling me.
Are you frightened in air raids, Hilda?
Me? I'm not frightened of anything. If you went about with as many service boys as I do, you wouldn't be either. Here we go. Your mother and father don't get on, do they, Mutt?
They aren't happy, no.
Is there another woman?
I can't really talk about it, Hilda. But... well, you know, I think there isn't one woman in particular.
It's no wonder you're browned off, then. Mum and I, we've been worrying about you all this week, and she's loved having you, you funny old stick. But she's been saying... something's changed about Margaret, tying her hair back like a schoolmarm.
I thought it looked nice and grown up.
It does. In that sweet little bow and everything. But with those big brown eyes, Mutt, you look so serious. It's like you've decided you're not a girl anymore. We just wondered, is there a boy?
Hilda, at that time you came to stay with us in Luton, I don't suppose you remember Frank Kennett, a friend of my brother Reg's.
Oh, yes. Fair boy. Rather quiet. He danced with you nearly all the time at the dance we went to with Reg's crowds.
That's him. Well, we used to go about together. Boys never did take me out much, you know. And Frank liked the things I like. Music, poetry... pictures. There was a repertory company at Northampton and we never missed a week. Shaw and Ibsen and Shakespeare and O'Neill.
Did he kiss you?
Sometimes.
I said to a RAF boy I was out with last Sunday, it's a good thing I don't want to kiss you as often as you want to kiss me or we never have time for anything else. Oh, Hilda, he said, just like that. Oh, Hilda. I had to laugh. I gave him one of my new Polly photos for luck. You be careful not to drop it over Berlin, I said. I don't want to be one of Goebbels' pin-up girls. But what about Frank, dear? Were you sort of in love with him?
I don't know. I did like him. But then Mother started... she thinks I should be married by now, you see. She's very down on old maids.
You're only 22. Same as me.
Yes, I know. And it's not as though she thinks so highly of marriage either. But every time Frank visited, she'd ask if he seemed to be cooling off and giving me hints about bringing him up to scratch. It got under my skin in the end. So I asked him. Outright.
What? You never?
Yes. I asked him outright whether he loved me or wanted to marry me. And he said he didn't. He didn't love me.
And that was perfectly all right, because you didn't love him, did you?
That's right, but then... afterwards, when I'd had a frightful scene with Mother, then I got thinking about how kind and quiet and sensible he was, and I thought... I thought I did love him. Just because he was unattainable. That's nutty.
I know.
Being in love with someone just because they don't love you. Oh, good. Mutt, if you'd just be sensible about it, you could probably pick and choose from a queue of people who'd be willing to love you back.
I don't know why I can't do that.
Well, I do. It's because you read too much. And you see too many plays.
You were looking as if your life had been forgiven you. Piers, what have I said?
You have absolved me.
Oh, Max has changed that lighting effect again.
I have absolved you?
Not you, but the imagination in you.
Excuse me, sir, you can't stand there.
Do you ever stop writing in your mind?
It's me, Hopkins.
Oh, Mr. Challis.
Ha! God knows! Do you ever stop breathing?
Yes!
How's it been tonight, Hopkins?
Not bad, sir.
You mean when I kissed you just now on the ramparts?
Stand by.
I suffer, Pierce.
Here we go. Excuse me, sir.
Yes, yes, yes.
You suffer.
Yes.
Yes.
Suffering is the anvil upon which the crystal sword of integrity is hammered.
The Steggles family moved to London 3 weeks later, and aside from the mysterious loss of some precious heirlooms...
Margaret! Those wretched men have lost the spoons!
Mrs. Steggles seemed as satisfied in Highgate as she had been in Luton. She was a woman who had, in living memory, never expressed happiness, and had moved 9 times in 23 years, so it evidently didn't matter very much where she made her residence. Taking her to see a tragedy such as Mountain Air as celebration for getting settled was perhaps a poor choice by Margaret, but on the other hand, it was meant well.
Well, I hate to be ungrateful, Margaret, but good gracious, what a relief when it stopped.
You didn't like it, did you, Mum?
Like it? I've never seen anything so silly in my life. Your father would have walked out the moment that first woman went mad and started playing that... What was it?
A Peruvian nose flute.
Well, trust you to know that. Get your gloves on, dear. It's perishing.
I think what it's about...
Botanists in the Andes, indeed. Why don't they talk like normal people? And why don't they do any botany? That's what I want to know. Oh. Margaret? What is it? Have you lost something?
Oh, no. I just found this in my pocket.
Your ration book?
No, it's not mine. I picked it up at Kenwood House and it's been in this coat ever since. That was nearly a month ago.
Oh, this is what comes of filling your head with nonsense, I must say. What's the name on it?
Hebean Island. There's a famous artist called Alexander Nyland. I don't suppose it could be anything to do with him.
Well, there's only one way to find out. Take it back, Margaret. Tomorrow. And don't you dare forget.
The afternoon was fine and windless, and many people were working on the allotments which had spread over Parliament Hill since 1939. When Margaret reached Romney Square, her heart beat quickly. So much of her craving for a more beautiful life took the form of wanting to meet interesting people, that the possibility of meeting one, even just to return his wife's lost ration book, excited her painfully.
Here it is. I've never met an artist before.
Grant, empty, thank goodness.
Mummy, Mummy!
Oh,
Mummy!
Oh, what a shame. I thought you were someone else. What is it, please? Mummy. Barnabas, darling, could you stop making that hideous noise for just one instant? Emma, dear, could you shh? Shh. Now.
I'm so sorry.
Whatever for? Have we met?
Mummy!
Barnabas.
I think this is yours, Mrs. Nyland. I'm so sorry. I found it about a month ago.
My ration book. Good heavens, where did you find it, you clever thing?
Outside Kenwood House.
I'm always losing it. Though actually, this time it was my husband.
Hey, where's Grunty?
Barnabas, please. We're waiting for my mother's maid to come. That's who we thought you were just now. I'm going to an absolutely lovely party. And Grant is looking after the brats. Oh, that's what we thought. Unless... Look, I'm sure you'd like to make up for keeping my book for ages like that.
What? Well, of course, it was awful of me.
Yes, it was hideously awful. A month more and I might have starved. Look at the condition I'm in.
Oh, dear. So,
if I hand you this one...
Oh, no.
Go, there you go.
Mrs. Nyland,
to the nice lady. She's called Emma.
Oh, hello, Emma.
She goes to anyone, don't you, honey bunch? Do come in. So if you just look after the two of them until Grant arrives, I'll completely forgive you for the ration book. This way.
Look, here we are.
The domain. Now, what do you need to know? Here's Emma's tin with the bead in it. Barnabas is making a house with coal. Only when Granty arrives, she won't let him. So, coat, gloves, do you think there's anything else? Goodbye, Barnabas.
Bye,
baby.
What's your name?
Margaret Steggles.
Well, goodbye, Margaret Steggles. Don't murder my children.
Oh, my goodness.
This wasn't quite what Margaret had had in mind when she knocked on the door of Lamb Cottage.
Oh, dear. There. Up and down.
To be left in sole charge of two strange children, one of them playing illicitly with coal, the other fixated on a tin with a bead in it. On the other hand, how effortlessly she had been absorbed into the elegant Hampstead home of a great, important painter.
That's Grunty!
Oh, that's enough, Barnabas! Now, what's going on in here?
Well, I think it's a nerve, dumping you with children like that.
Grunty was nice in the end.
And that's another thing. Granty? What's her real name?
Mrs. Grant, I suppose.
You watch out, they don't start calling you Stegglesy, that's all.
Oh, Hilda. Oh, Stegglesy, just top up the pot, would you? Oh, aren't you a treasure?
Hilda, that's not funny.
But I haven't got to the best thing. Granty works at Westwood, the house on the hill I can see from my bedroom. And who do you think she works for?
Clark Gable.
Gerard Challis. The man who wrote Mountain Air. If only I could get Granty to invite me into Westwood.
They're only people, Margaret.
Oh.
How long did you stay?
Granty made me leave with her to get the bus back at 7, otherwise I might have stayed longer. Mr. Nyland, the painter, was there, and he didn't really say much. And when Mrs. Nyland came back, she brought a very nice American soldier called Earl.
Oh, yes. A cut above our British boys, I suppose.
Well, he was an English professor in Kansas before the war.
And that took you in completely.
Miss Steggles and I ought to be going. We're going to catch the bus.
Oh, what a shame. It's been a pleasure to meet you.
Goodbye, Mrs. Nyland, and thank you. I have enjoyed it so. I'm a great admirer of your father's work. I've seen Mountain Air 3 times.
Good heavens. Once was more than enough for me. Well, I must say, you've been an angel with the brats. You must be nearly dead. Bye-bye.
Come along, Miss Steggles.
Has she gone?
Yes.
Who was she again?
Oh, her name is Stubbles or something.
I don't know. She found my ration book.
But you should have seen her face when I handed her Emma. Talk about her mouth like an O.
Thank you.
Some weeks had passed since the weekend of Hebe Nyland's ration book, and life was continuing as normal in this, the fifth winter of the war. On the underground train home from the food department, Hilda stood between an American soldier and an old man who smelled of beer. Fortunately, both for Hilda and the soldier, they were standing face to face. And every time the train lurched...
Oops-a-daisy.
Up swept Hilda's eyelashes, and her blue eyes met the soldier's, and they both smiled. For Hilda, flirtation was a wonderfully harmless way of keeping people's spirits up. It helped, of course, that she was spectacularly pretty and drew admiring looks from all quarters, including, on this occasion, from a tall, intellectual-looking man who happened to be a famous playwright.
What nymph-like eyes,
he thought to himself.
What joy to wake their coolness into warmth.
Gerard Challis disliked the human race and was only travelling by underground from Whitehall because his Daimler was out of order. And he'd been unable to persuade a taxi driver to drive him out to Highgate in the increasing fog. But now he was glad. Before him was a face of delicate, aquiline beauty with brilliant eyes of sea blue.
Oops-a-daisy.
This gentleman craved romantic and spiritual sustenance. As a playwright, he invariably fell in love with his unattainable heroines, women of fire and dew who represented the eternal mistress of man, did the honourable and interesting thing with a nose flute, and never accused their husbands of causing headaches with their pallor.
Strange, what a fog.
See you round in front of your face.
Oh, no.
The gentleman seized his chance.
Are you all right?
My torch has given out. It would.
Ha-ha. And I have been sent by Providence to escort you. My torch, as you see, is in excellent order.
You're right there. It's a young searchlight. Aren't you lucky?
Very. You see, this hasn't happened by chance. We were fated to meet. You must allow me to walk you home. I assure you, I'm respectable.
Well, I want to get to Alderney Gardens at the bottom of Simpson's Lane. Do you know where that is?
Would you care to take my arm?
I wouldn't care to, but I suppose I'll have to. Isn't this awful? My mother will be worrying herself silly.
You have a mother?
Oh, of course I've got a mother. What on earth are you driving at?
Your eyes. They look as if your mother might have been... Thetis. Don't you want to know who Thetis was?
I can't wait.
She was a sea goddess.
Fancy.
I'm suggesting you were not of mortal born.
Are you on the BBC?
Good heavens, no. You odd child, why do you ask?
You talk like it.
No. Oh, careful on the curb here. No, not the BBC. I have nothing to do with that institution for perverting the taste and moulding the opinion of the masses. If I told you my name, I doubt you would know it.
Shall I have three guesses?
As you please.
Archibald Screwy.
Screwy? No, nowhere near it.
Freddie Griswood.
No, I told you I'm not on the BBC.
Dr. Goebbels? No, you don't have a limp. I give up.
Oh, so soon. Alderney Gardens. I would like you to think of me as Marcus.
Marcus it is. And here we are.
May I see you again? Please say yes.
Marcus, if I saw every boy again who asked me to, I should never go to business or have time for a perm or get any meals. Aren't you married?
No.
You look as if you are.
May I at least know your name?
With pleasure. It's Hilda Wilson.
Yeah. I would prefer to think of you as Daphne.
Well, so would I, but Hilda it is, and that's all there is to it. Now, you run along home, Marcus.
Yeah, but...
And thanks again.
Hilda! Oh, is that you?
Sorry, Mum. It's an awful night. Who do you think saw me home, though? Freddie Griswood!
The staff of Westwood had been much reduced by 4 years of war. It now comprised just three people: Granty, Granty's brother Courtway, and Miss Zita Mandelbaum, a German refugee.
Mrs. Grant asked if you want fire in the room.
Oh, no, thank you, Zita. We'll be going out shortly.
Oh.
Is everything all right, Zita?
Everything, yes. Except that I am so sad. But you do not want that I tell you about it.
Not now, no.
The Challises, being blessed with adamantine insensitivity to the feelings of others, were perfectly able to cope with Zita, who had been, as they put it, through beastly things in Hamburg. Easily hurt and easily moved, Zita was not a pretty young woman. Her moustache was clearly visible on her upper lip. Yet she was never without a lover. In fact, her love affairs were more turbulent than anything in Gerard Challis's plays.
I'm sorry to hear you're sad again, Zita. Look, there's a lovely concert on the wireless tonight at 8 o'clock. Be sure you don't miss it.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Challis. That is good. I shall enjoy much to hear it. It will make my heart cry, and I shall then be better.
Yes. If Margaret Steggles thought she had passionate feelings, they were as nothing to the feelings of Zita Mandelbaum, as she was very soon to discover at Mr. Hudson the ironmonger's.
What is for the party, Mr. Hudson?
You said...
Mrs. Challis is giving a party this evening.
I know.
And the fuse he has blown out this afternoon. He blew out.
Please calm yourself, Miss Mandelbaum.
Courtfey is away today. There is a party for Mrs. Nyland's new baby, and if you do not mend the fuse, Mr. Hudson, there will be no light in the hall and in the drawing room.
Hello, Mr. Hudson.
Oh, Miss Steggles. I'll be with you in a moment.
Of course.
Now, Miss Mandelbaum.
Yes,
I'll get my man down to Westwood as soon as I can.
Westwood?
Yes, Westwood, Margaret. At last.
But the party!
Very awkward, I can see that. But we manage to do so many things in the dark these days, don't we? Case of having to.
No.
Could you excuse me for a moment, ladies?
No, of course.
Mr. Hudson! Oh, my God.
Highgate 235.
Westwood, Margaret. You must seize your chance.
Excuse me, Miss Mandelbaum. Did Mr. Hudson say you lived at Westwood?
That is right, yes.
Take a deep breath.
My name is Margaret Steggles. I had the pleasure of meeting Mrs. Nyland a few weeks ago when I returned her ration book.
Very good. Oh, well done.
So, it is you who finds the ration book?
And I was just thinking... Well, look here, I can mend a fuse.
You can mend a fuse?
Yes.
Then you must come. Let me go now. Now, this minute. I take you there.
If you're sure.
Thank you, Mr. Hudson. Please.
Go.
Margaret tried not to think about the rather demeaning manner of her introduction to the charmed world of the Challises.
This way. We are nearly there.
After all, the first time she had encountered the Challis family, it had been in the guise of an honest peasant. Now it was as an amateur electrician taking advantage of a desperate moustachioed refugee. On the other hand...
Here we are, Mr.
On the other hand, to get things in their right perspective, she was in.
It is in here. Now, I go first, you come after. Oh, be careful, Miss Steggles. There is bump in the floor.
I see it. I'll have a look. Right. That one's all right. Do you have any fuse wire? 5 amp?
I have no idea. I do not know what that is, but it may be in this box.
Oh.
Miss Steggles, what is your name?
Margaret.
So, I shall call you Margaret. You will call me Zita, if you like.
Oh, good.
Zita? Is that you in there?
We mend the fuse, Mrs. Grant. It is Miss Steggles.
Is it indeed?
She was in Mr. Hudson's shop.
How convenient.
Yep. Here we are. Here's the broken one. Oh. Right now I need a screwdriver. Small one. All right. That's good.
You have the mind for machinery, Margaret. It is a gift. Me, I have it not. But I do not care. I have the artist's soul. It is better.
There. Zita, do you like to go and test it?
I am afraid.
Whatever for?
Oh, sometimes there is a blue light and you go bang!
I'll come with you. Oh, it's beautiful.
You think so? So do I. We like the same things, Margaret. I am sure you like music.
Oh, I do. And poetry.
Oh, no. What have you done?
Me?
Zita, what on earth are you doing? The blackout. I could see the light as I came up the hill.
Gerard Challis. It was Gerard Challis himself. I am so sorry, Mr. Challis. We have been mending the fuses and we forget. Mr. Challis, may I introduce to you Miss Margaret Steggles? She is my friend.
Mr. Challis's manner when he met a new young woman was invariable and automatic. He drew himself up and turned on her from his imposing height his full, grave regard.
So?
It worked every time.
So you have been mending my fuses, Miss Steggles? Are you an electrician by profession?
It wasn't anything. It was easy, really.
You found it easy, no doubt. I admire you, but I'm also a little afraid of you. I know that I could not mend a fuse.
Oh, Mr. Challis.
Now, may I escort you to the gate?
Oh. Oh, well, yes, of course. Goodbye, Zita.
Here is my telephone number. You must telephone me.
As he opened the front door, Challis turned to her once more with that grave, searching look.
There is a helpless quality, don't you agree, about a house that is prepared for a party?
Well, yes, although it does look very pretty.
The silence and flowers are like victims, awaiting the noise of conversation and the cigarette smoke and the dissonant jar of conflicting personalities that shall presently destroy them.
Margaret was in heaven. She had never heard anyone use a phrase such as dissonant jar in her presence before. It was hard to know what to say. Unfortunately, she thought of something.
Please forgive me, Mr. Challis, but I do want you to know that this is the greatest moment of my life.
Thank you, my child. Tributes such as yours are very sweet to an artist, especially when he recalls them in moments of discouragement or doubt. And on a more practical note, thank you for mending our fuse.
Oh, it was nothing.
And I hope that we may meet again. Good night.
Good night.
Margaret could not help herself. She stood watching until his tall form had disappeared into the dusk. Then she began to walk quickly, dreamily homewards, with her mind in exquisite confusion. It would be easy to forget in all this domestic whirl that in the winter of 1943 there was still a war on. However, in the weeks before Christmas, Gerard Challis's ministry job did not prevent him from working on Cata, which was to be his masterpiece, and pursuing Hilda, which was pointless. Meanwhile, Margaret had little choice but to form an intense bond of friendship with Zita. First, because Zita allowed no emotional half measures, and second, because she was immensely touchy and brooked no opposition.
To a con, concert we will go together?
No. Oh, yes.
Good. I have buy two tickets. It is wonderful Lieder by Schubert and Brahms and Wolf. I buy one for my friend. But now he is my friend no more.
Oh, dear, I'm so sorry.
No, Margaret. It is a good thing I find him out. He is a rubbish. Oh, you laugh. Margaret, it is good. Too sad is your face.
Is it? I didn't know that.
Oh, yes. When I see you first, I think you are a widow or some girl who has been betrayed. So, we meet tomorrow outside the Apollonian Hall at 3 o'clock. You will hear the songs of Hugo Wolf and you will love them.
Luckily, Sita was right. Margaret had never heard anything so beautiful as the concert of German songs on that Sunday afternoon.
You like it?
Oh, yes, it's wonderful.
We have the good seats. 3 weeks ago, I booked these seats. They are 8 shillings and 6 pence each.
8 and 6?
If my friend had come with me, of course, he would have paid the money again to me. He was a rubbish, but he paid for himself.
And of course, you must let me do the same.
Oh, I hope so. I hope so, for I am not rich, Margaret.
Let's always do halves in future, shall we? Hilda and I always do.
Hilda? She's not half your friend?
Oh, yes, my oldest friend, really.
You like her better than me?
But being friends with the sensitive Zita meant that Margaret could, at last, come and go from Westwood as she pleased. Together they sat in a small sewing room in the evenings, Margaret often marking her school books, Zita wielding a needle, listening to concerts from the BBC, and sometimis visited by Mrs. Challis. Mr. Challis, Margaret did not see again for several weeks. Partly because, unknown to her, he was generally out making a fool of himself over her best friend, Hilda. When Christmas came, Zita gave Margaret an enormous handbag of black, green and yellow silk, which she took to the Wilsons' New Year's Eve party.
Oh, I say, Mark, who'd you have to knock down for that?
The refugee at Westwood made it for me. You know, Zita Mandelbaum. She's nice, truly, Hilda.
She better be with a name like that. Oh, hello, Shirley. Pat. Go on up and leave your things. We did wonder if you'd come, the three of you. Mum, I don't know how to say this, but your mum looks positively cheerful.
Dad's bringing a friend from the office, is that all right? They'll be here before midnight, he said.
Of course it's all right. The more the merrier. How about sardines? Did someone say sardines?
Do we have to?
I'll pretend I didn't hear that. Come on, Matt. Turn off the light. We'll start.
Here. Shh. Are you in?
Yes.
Margaret couldn't help thinking that at Westwood this evening, they would not be playing sardines.
I've got a new boyfriend.
You always have.
Ah, but this one isn't a boy. He's rather old, really, and ever so rich. I dined with him last week, and, my dear, where do you think we went? I'd never heard of it, but it's called Jones's Hotel, and it's miles away at the back of Hyde Park, and the bill came to £5. I couldn't help seeing.
Has he kissed you?
Not yet. I haven't let him. He's in agony, poor old soul. Oh, Daphne, your eyes. Oh, Daphne, your hair.
Who's Daphne?
Me! But what about you, Mutt? I don't suppose you're any nearer to finding a real boy.
I'm further off than ever, I think. Have you heard of Mrs. Norton, the poet? I do not love thee. No, I do not love thee. And yet when thou art absent, I am sad, and envy e'en the bright blue sky above thee. whose quiet stars may see thee and be glad.
Oh, isn't that lovely? Is it my turn?
There was an old man from Calcutta.
Hello. Who are you?
It's all right. I'm not gate-crashing. I'm Dick Fletcher, friend and colleague of Jack Steggles. Butcher.
Pleased to meet you. I'm Hilda Wilson, and this thing here...
Hello.
..is Jack Steggles' only daughter, Margaret Mabel.
How do you do, Margaret Mabel?
How do you do?
Margaret had never met Dick Fletcher before. She could make out a high forehead, faintly reflecting the light, and the dim outlines of a clean-shaven face. Unfortunately for his fellow sardines, he brought with him into their hiding place a pungent odour of tobacco and beer.
Did I interrupt something?
Nothing important. You don't know any poetry off by heart, I suppose, Dick Fletcher?
No.
Oh, that's a relief.
This seems rather a good party.
Do you think so?
Room for a little one.
I'm enjoying it anyway.
Banja!
Oh, thank heavens for that. Another minute and I should have melted.
So 1944 began with singing and kissing, and Mr. Steggles invited Dick Fletcher to spend the night as he had missed the last bus home. Mrs. Steggles was outraged, of course, but Margaret urged the invitation, seeing that her mother wasn't going to.
Well, you can make the bed, Margaret.
Of course. Here, let me have that.
Whose house is it, I should like to know?
Mother, but we do owe him Dad's job. If it weren't for Dick recommending him, Dad wouldn't be at the Gazette and we wouldn't be living in London.
Oh, I'm so tired, Margaret.
You know you don't really mind. And he's nice enough, isn't he, Mr. Fletcher?
Oh, yes. And it's so sad for him. That awful woman.
What awful woman? Oh, yes, of course, he's divorced, isn't he?
And he divorced her. And you know what that means. Dad says there's even a child in the picture somewhere.
A child?
Dad's asked Dick to come out here on a Sunday and he never will. Oh, a man on his own with a child. Dick Fletcher needs somebody, that's what.
Please, Mother. Please don't start thinking of him as a match for me.
Oh, I won't. No, I'm afraid you aren't the type that attracts men, Margaret, so we better face it. I'll come down and make some coffee when you've finished.
Margaret suddenly thought that if she didn't have Westwood and Gerard Challis's beautiful plays, she would have nothing in her life. Nothing.
Why are you crying, cat?
I'm not crying. It's just that the tears come.
Perfect. Perfect, everybody.
Van Trapp is not suffering anymore, cat. He is not unhappy. How can he be, now that he has flung himself into the freezing Danube entirely on your account?
It wasn't for him that I was crying, dear Nanny. Not for him.
For Kurt, perhaps. He also is in a better place since casting himself beneath the cruel hooves of the Lipizzaners of the Spanish Riding School.
No, nor for Kurt.
Then, why?
Shouldn't there be a line there, Gerard, darling? It says
course.
Yeah, I just want you to hang your head, Marion.
Really? But...
As written, please, everybody.
But when the old nanny...
Could we just try it as written, please? From, it wasn't for him.
If you say so. It wasn't for him that I was crying. Mm-hmm. Not for him.
Then why?
Very good.
I still think it needs a line, dear. Oh. So do I.
Margaret's feelings were still a girl's feelings, but they were stronger than those of most girls, and she was not satisfied by the glimpses she had of Gerard Challis. She longed to talk to him, to be his friend, his disciple, his acolyte. How happy she was then, one day, to arrive at the little sewing room and find Challis seated by the open window.
Mr. Challis.
Oh, Miss,
Steggles.
Steggles, of course. Well, come in. I shall not disturb you if I remain here a little while.
Oh, no. Are you sure I shan't disturb you?
Oh, no, no.
Are you absorbing the atmosphere, Mr. Challis?
Women have been imprisoned in this little room for 200 years.
Really?
Oh, yes. Women, with their half-formed desires, here they sat, sewing.
Margaret didn't know what to think. This cheerful room was lovely.
I want to convey, in one sentence of dialogue, one sentence, mind, the feeling of half-conscious imprisonment that was sewn into the hemming of handkerchiefs. The sunlight is warm on your cheek and your hands experience the fine texture of the chiffon which you are sewing.
No, this is only net.
The textile is hardly significant. My point is that you think you are free. But are you?
Well, I'm freer than most girls my age.
I mean free in spirit. Freedom of body is nothing.
Margaret could not have been more uncomfortable. She wanted to agree with Challis to please him, but how could she? Freedom of body is nothing. How could he say that? When there was a war on, when there were people imprisoned all over Europe.
Freedom of body is quite important at a time like this, Mr. Challis.
No. The mind is all. And you, Miss Steggles, are you free?
No. But only because I am not happy in love.
Happiness is the food of fools. No fully adult being wants to be happy.
Oh.
The power that shapes us is not happiness. It is suffering, privation, abnegation, yearning. Oh, what is it?
Hello, Pops. I heard you holding forth all down the corridor. Oh, hello.
Hello, Mrs. Nyland.
Do you know, this room has always smelt of old rags. Come on, Pops. Barnabas has been asking for his grandpa for ages.
Oh, very well. Good day, Miss Steggles. I wish you'd tell the boy to call me Gerald.
You are his grandpa, though, Pops.
Yes, but my name is also Gerald.
In all of us, there is a struggle between romance and common sense. But for young women of a wistful disposition, the whispers of common sense go unheeded. Common sense would have whispered to Margaret to run away from Westwood and never come back. The people at Westwood were hateful, and she couldn't remember the last time they'd offered her a cup of tea. But Margaret did not hearken to common sense. She clung to Westwood and adored Gerard Challis, despite his evident disdain for her. In fact, the more he disdained her, the more senselessly devoted she became.
I
I do not love thee. Yet thy speaking eyes, with their deep, bright, and most expressive blue, between me and the midnight heaven arise, oftener than any eyes I ever knew.
He was holding forth to struggles.
Oh, darling, need you call her that? It's too perfect. But is it kind?
You should have seen her. She looked like a dog waiting for paid for.
I know I do not love thee. Yet, alas, others will scarcely trust my candid heart. And oft I catch them smiling as they pass, because they see me gazing where thou art.
In the first episode of Westwood by Stella Gibbons, Margaret was played by Juliet Aubrey, Challis by Michael Fenton Stevens, Hilda by Saffron Burrows, and Hebe by Caroline Harker. Zita was played by Mia Sotirio, Serafina by Phyllida Nash, and Dick by Jonathan Nibbs. Angela Barlow was Mrs. Steggles, Chris Donnelly was Mr. Hudson, Barbara Kellerman was Mrs. Wilson, Martin T. Sherman was Earl, and Jacqueline Tong, Granty. Westwood was adapted for radio by Lynne Truss and narrated by Rosemary Leach. It was produced in Bristol by Kate McCall.
This video was uploaded to the channel Thinking Out Louder. Please like, comment and subscribe to the Thinking Out Louder channel. Thank you.
It's 3 o'clock. Hello, this is Joanna Pinnock. It's drama next, and the conclusion of our story, Westwood, by Cold Comfort Farm creator Stella Gibbons. Then at four, was Albert Einstein's brain really stolen? We're talking after his death, naturally. Giles Brandreth helped sort the truth from the fibs in Whispers, and the very funny David Sedaris is back on 4 Extra this week, his take on same-sex marriage at 5:30. To wartime London now, though, on 4 Extra. Westwood is the elegant home of the wealthy and rather snobbish Challis family, who, thanks to a dropped ration book, have come to know the earnest and rather plain schoolteacher, Margaret Steggles. She has promptly fallen in love with Gerard Challis, a self-important, pompous playwright, while he has set his sights on her flirty childhood friend, Hilda.
Episode 2 of Westwood by Stella Gibbons. Adapted for radio by Lynne Truss. With Juliet Aubrey as Margaret Steggles, Michael Fenton Stevens as Gerard Challis, and Saffron Burrows as Hilda Wilson. Westwood is narrated by Rosemary Leach.
The first night of Gerard Challis's new play, Cata, finally arrived on the 4th of May, 1944. There was not an empty seat in the house.
Ah, my lord. Ah. Good evening, Challis.
Thank you for coming.
Good evening.
Oh, hello, darling.
Jerry.
Well, this is it, Serafina. Your husband is giving Cata to the world.
Jerry, you look superb in that rig. I always loved you in dove grey.
Oh, thank you, darling. If only the critics judge one's plays according to one's first night attire. Unfortunately, that is almost never the case.
Pops.
Oh, hear me.
I brought Earl along.
Good evening, sir.
He wanted to come, Pops. I can't think why. I keep telling him. You know it's 3 hours.
Sir, this is a mighty privilege.
Well, yes.
Ah, Cata. For months now, at Westwood, his house in Highgate, Challis had been working on this highly serious play. Parcels of books about turn-of-the-century Vienna had arrived weekly from the London Library. Challis had steeped himself in the works of Arthur Schnitzler. For a whole weekend, he had learned German. Up in the gallery, schoolteacher Margaret Steggles and her friend Zita Mandelbaum, a maid at Westwood, were as excited as anybody.
Oh, Zita, to think that I was sometimes in the house while Gatta was being written. Look, Zita, in the stalls in the third row, there's Hebe. Oh, yes. And Mrs. Challis looking so beautiful.
The one person missing from the theatre this evening, as far as Challis was concerned, was Hilda Wilson, his muse, his Daphne, the young, beautiful woman with whom he was insanely in love. For months, Challis had wooed her under an assumed name.
Marcus it is. Now, you run along home, Marcus.
Yeah, but,
And thanks again.
How long had he planned to bring this lovely woman to the play she had inspired and reveal to her in his moment of glory his true, magnificent identity? Somewhat like Zeus appearing to Danae in a shower of gold. Then, he felt, then she would surely love him.
A friend of mine is writing a play.
That's clever of him. But I suppose someone has to.
Oh, Daphne.
I've told you before, Marcus, my name's Hilda.
It's about a girl who is a victim of her own power to charm.
What on earth do you mean?
I mean that she cannot help men falling in love with her. And when you... this fact causes pain and suffering, she finally comes to loathe her own power.
Whatever for?
Because she makes men suffer, even as you do.
I do nothing of the sort, Marcus. My boys are always ever so cheery. What happens to her in the end?
She kills herself.
What a mind your friend must have. Well, I might as well tell you, Marcus, I'd rather not see it, and that's that.
You mean you won't come at all? My friend will be very disappointed.
Too bad about him. But you can tell him from me, there's enough misery in the world, especially nowadays, without writing stuff like that.
My dear child, oh, how little you understand. The world needs the purging power of tragedy now as never before.
Well, I don't, so your friend's got another guest coming. It's our taxi. Aren't we lucky?
Oh, Zita, it's starting.
Margaret, who happened to be Hilda's best friend, thought Challis was the cleverest and most wonderful man alive. Blinded by devotion, she failed to notice that Challis roundly despised all the real women in his life, and there were many, and added insult to injury by inventing stage heroines of staggering inauthenticity.
There is a helpless quality about a house that is prepared for a party. The silence and the flowers are like victims, awaiting the noise of conversation and the cigarette smoke and dissonant jar of conflicting personalities that shall presently destroy them.
Eat the goulash, Gatte.
Oh, isn't it sad?
Where is your goldfinch, Nanny? Why is the cage so empty?
I had to sell it.
Why?
To buy food for you.
Oh.
And do you know, when I left my precious bird with his new owner, he fluttered his wings as if to say, if my beady eye shall shine as a beauteous cat no longer, I shall have to kill myself. No.
Pops has surpassed himself this time, I must say.
Why are you crying, Carter?
I'm not crying. It's just... the tears come.
Carter!
What are you doing?
beauty. And yet, such power to destroy.
Oh, no. Cedar, I can't bear it.
Let me take that service revolver from your lovely hand.
Now that's a shame. I liked her.
Thank you, thank you. You're too kind. You're really too kind. Thank you.
What? What happened?
Mr. Fletcher wants you on the telephone.
Telephone? What time is it?
It's about 8 o'clock. Come on.
Yes, yes, I'm coming. Who did you say it was?
Get your dressing gown. Mr. Fletcher. Dad's friend. I don't know what it's about, but he wants to speak to you. He says it's urgent. This is what comes of staying out all night at the theatre. You can't get up on Saturday morning. She's just coming, Mr. Fletcher.
Dick?
Margaret? Is that you? I'm sorry to get you out of bed, Margaret, but I'm in a hole and I need your help. Can you meet me outside Brockdale Station in half an hour?
Half an hour? Yes, of course, Dick.
Good. I'll explain later.
Well, what did he want?
Well, I don't know, except that I've got to go to Brockdale.
Why?
I don't know, Mother. It's a shame. I was hoping to see Zita today to talk about the reviews. I was hoping I might even see Mr. Challis and congratulate him on his play.
Brockdale, Westwood, plays. Margaret, I suppose it's occurred to you that your father and I never see you. You can't imagine how worried we were last night.
Oh, Mum.
No, when that air raid started. And where were you? Out with some German refugee at the theatre.
I told you, I was on the underground by the time of the raid. I was perfectly safe. Well, I came straight home, and neither of you knew you'd be worried.
Oh, now who's this? Hello.
Oh, Mrs. Steggles, is Margaret there, please?
Oh, Miss Mandelbaum, I suppose.
Yeah, I am Miss Mandelbaum. Margaret. Friend.
Well, if you're expecting her at Westwood today, Miss Mandelbaum, I'm afraid she has other arrangements.
Is it for me?
Other arrangements? No, I must speak with Margaret, please. A bomb last night, a bomb hit, bang, the house of Mr. and Mrs. Nyland in Hampstead. And the family is safe, but all are at Westwood now. The three children and Miss Hebe and Mr. Alexander. Mm-hmm. And the housekeeper, Mrs. Grant, has been taken very ill. And there is only me to cope. I tell Mrs. Challis, Margaret will help me.
Did you indeed?
Oh, Margaret always laughed to hell.
Well, I'll certainly pass on the message when I see her.
No, you don't understand.
Oh, I think I do.
Please, Mrs. Steggles, impossible here it is.
I'll tell her you called. Goodbye.
No, hey.
Who was that?
Oh, no one important. I'll tell you later. Well, run then, Margaret, or you'll never get there on time.
The day after a Challis first night was never entirely comfortable at Westwood. This one had many reasons to be no exception.
Serafina! Look what I found in my bath. A child's rubber monster. This is insufferable.
Hello, darling. Nice review in the Times?
I haven't looked.
Of course you haven't, darling.
There was, of course, a rather picky review in the Times.
It's like living in Charing Cross Hospital in this house. Or a field kitchen. I need to work, Serafina. I need peace.
Yes, darling.
There are children everywhere.
Well, they are your grandchildren, Jerry. Not evacuees from the East End with knits.
Well, there's people with bedding and... Where is Granty while all this is going on? Sita tells me she's lying down.
Jerry, I'm afraid Granty's really bad. Dr. James says we must have a nurse for her.
Really?
I've already arranged it. And I've asked Zita to call Struggles for a bit of help.
Huh?
Miss Steggles, darling. Hebe always calls her Struggles, sometimes her face. Actually, she doesn't seem to mind. You know the girl with the dark hair? Friend of Zita's. Very serious. And mad on you.
Oh, well, yes. Well, good idea. She seems to have a lot of leisure time. Do you mean Grant is going to die because of one small bomb that missed her?
Apparently her heart was much worse than we knew. But she didn't tell anybody, you see.
Oh. Well, it's strange to think of Granty dying.
Mm.
She's one of those figures I've always taken for granted.
I know.
A background figure, so familiar that one never thinks of her. It's as if she were one's toothbrush or something of that sort.
Oh, dear.
It will be like offering a cup of superb wine to a creature without a palate.
What?
I was speculating how a creature like Granty will face something as immense as death.
Oh, well. Well, she believes in heaven, of course. She prays for us all, Jerry, every night. And I'm sure God listens to her. Dear, good, kind old thing. Oh, dear, it's so awful to think of her dying.
Well, does Dr. James give her no hope at all?
He said she was just worn out.
Look, Seraphina, don't distress yourself, really. Granty has enjoyed giving her life to us. She is a slave by temperament and has passed her life in slavery, therefore she is fulfilled.
What a beastly thing to say!
No, it isn't. Some people are natural slaves. Granty, Courtway, that Steggles girl. In the ancient world, slaves were frequently figures of nobility. I'm not being unfeeling, Seraphina.
Oh. I look like the wrath of God. How are the reviews really, Jerry?
Well, most of them seem to find fault.
Oh, poor Jerry.
But unfortunately, they don't agree where the fault lies.
Margaret. This is good of you.
Dick.
I thought you might have other plans.
Well, I did, really, but... Oh, it's quite all right. Is it bad news?
Give me your arm.
Oh, well, all right.
Now, quick march. I'll explain on the way.
Margaret was very conscious of Dick's arm thrust carelessly through her own. Women who are not often touched by men respond strongly when they are touched, however casually. It makes them swell and feel light-headed, especially if they haven't had any breakfast.
My housekeeper, Mrs. Coates, was hurt in the raid last night, you see.
Oh.
She's in hospital and likely to be there for at least 3 weeks. The trouble is, there's no one to look after my daughter. You don't know about my daughter, I suppose?
Well, Mother did mention you had a child.
I don't talk about it much. Linda lives out here with Mrs. Coates, and I visit on Sundays. You see, the trouble is, Linda isn't quite like other children.
Really?
She's not quite up to the standard of her age, so she doesn't go to school or see that many people. You look worried.
No, no.
Good, because there's no reason to be. I wondered if you could spend the day here just until I can get a nurse or somebody. She's very loving and gentle. You'll love her.
Well, it's a pretty house.
Those are Linda's wind bells. Come along.
Oh. Huh.
What is it?
The name of the house. It's called Westwood.
That's right.
I'm very fond of another house called Westwood in Highgate. I sometimes wish I could live there.
Well, I hope you feel the same way about this one. Linda? Darling, it's Daddy. Mm. Ah, there you are.
Linda was about 10 years old. Her face was dark and calm. Her dark hair was plaited with red ribbons, and she wore a flowered dress. Margaret was relieved. Although it was awful to admit it, her imagination had begun to paint a monster. Whereas Linda was just distant, as if she were at the bottom of a well.
This is Margaret. She's going to stay with you today while Daddy goes to work.
Hello, Linda. Are those your wind bells?
She won't say much, but she's very happy, truly. Mrs. Coates is devoted to her.
Look, Dick, you know I can't come every day. I have to be at school during the week.
Of course. I wouldn't dream of asking you. I'll get in touch with the WVS first thing on Monday.
Well, I suppose I could come at weekends. And after school.
Really? Oh, you are a brick. Well, I must go. Linda, give Daddy a kiss. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
There was something soothing about being alone here with Linda. Margaret wished she could be at Westwood in Highgate, of course.
Do you know what the Times said about Cata?
No. What?
They said it was painstaking.
Painstaking. Oh, it's all right.
But somehow today, a house called Westwood in Brockdale had got to her first.
It's the sort of house a child film star would live in,
Margaret thought, looking about her. There was a kitten to play with, and a goldfish to watch, and a garden of beautiful flowers. She didn't like to remember how easily she had volunteered for 3 weeks rushing from Highgate to Brockdale at the expense of the Challises, Hilda and her parents, just to help this man she hardly knew. But on the other hand, as she sat with Linda in the garden on that sunny morning and looked forward to a day of preparing food and picking flowers and darning stockings from the workbox, she realised there was something very special about Dick's little house. It made her feel at home.
He's not my boyfriend, Zita. He's years older than I am.
Margaret's new role as Dick's helper was predictably unpopular in some quarters.
Then why have you not told me about him? You close your heart to me, Margaret. Can you not trust me with your secret?
It isn't a secret. He needed help with his little girl and he turned to me. That's all.
You are in love with him. Oh. All week I phone you and you are not there. The house is bedlam, Margaret. I cope all alone. And Mrs. can't talk of God all the day. And Mrs. Challis says, there is Miss Steggles. And now there is the party for Cat. And Lady Challis will be here.
Lady Challis? His mother?
Oh, but you are so busy with your Dick Fletcher.
Please, try to understand. I would be there with you if I could, but I said I'd go to Brockdale every day until Dick's housekeeper is better. Zita, you know I love Westwood.
Ah, you love Westwood.
You know what I mean. Oh, look, I'll come. I'll come and I'll help.
You mean it?
Yes.
You will tell your Dick this?
I will tell Dick, yes.
You are in love with Dick.
No!
Then I will tell Mrs. Challis.
Good.
On the night of the party, Gerard Challis was slow to join his guests, for his heart was full of sadness. His plan, ever since she refused to come to the play, had been to take his Daphne, the beautiful Hilda, to the Bluebell Wood at Kew, sit her down in a place of sublime, silent, unutterable azure loveliness, reveal his true identity, shower of gold and so on, and declare his love. But now the bluebells had passed, and the best he had been able to get from her was a half-promise to go with him in 2 weeks' time. Had he been a true advocate of the philosophy of his own plays, of course, he would have taken himself to a picturesque location and shot himself. But strangely, this romantic course of action had never once occurred to him.
2 weeks is a long time to wait.
Well, ever so sorry and all that, Marcus, but it can't be helped. Your blessed old Kew Gardens will still be there, surely.
The blossoming trees will be all over.
All over what? Marcus, are you still there?
Yes.
Oh, I thought you'd gone. Listen, I'll try and make it on Saturday fortnight. Phone me up the day before in case I forget, but I'll try and keep it free. Bye-bye.
Daphne. Oh, Daphne.
And here was Margaret at the party, serving drinks and listening to literary conversation. I remember I thought when I first saw her, now there is a candidate for the gentle powers. A young woman with a mind of her own, held in a strange spell by people who saw her only as a pair of helping hands.
Lady Challis, may I introduce my dear friend, Margaret Steggles?
How do you do?
How do you do, Lady Challis?
I have been telling Margaret about your martel field and your rough house is there in the country, a whole band together like one big house.
It sounds very romantic.
It's very practical, actually, Miss Steggles. And there is a lot of space for books, which I think is most important.
Oh, I want a house full of books one day.
I leave you, Margaret. But I call if I need you to help.
Ah, here you are.
Oh, Hebe, my favourite granddaughter.
Been doing a valiant job with the brats, as always, I suppose, Miss Steggles.
Well,
it's amazing how this young woman is always at hand in a crisis, Grandma. Uncanny, almost.
I was very sorry to hear about the bomb, Mrs. Nyland.
Not half as sorry as me. You know, we're all having to live here until we can find something. It's a rigid bind. Grant has virtually bought it, poor old thing.
Oh, no. Oh, I heard she was ill.
Talks about God all the time. She says this bee war is his way of putting an end to wars altogether. Well, work that out. Ah, there's Earl. Thank God, I'm off.
Well, I should help Sita. It's lovely to meet you, Lady Chase.
No, 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 I want you to talk to me. Have you seen Kata?
Oh, yes. I was there on the first night.
No, the thing is, I never see Jerry's plays. It annoys him dreadfully. But is Kata too tragic? Or perhaps you haven't thought about it?
Oh, no. I've thought about Kata every minute since I saw it.
The common view seems to be that, well, in times of war, everyone's too browned off for tragedy.
No, I disagree.
Really?
Oh, yes. True tragedy liberates our emotions. Fear and pity raise our souls. But with Kata... Oh, it doesn't matter what I think.
I won't tell anyone.
Well, parts of Kata were very beautiful.
Oh, dear.
But as a matter of fact, I wasn't sure it was a tragedy.
Why?
It was the way people kept shooting themselves.
I beg your pardon? The way what?
The way people kept shooting themselves.
Yes?
It was more like a... Well, it was more like a disaster.
Oh, Jerry. Jerry, there you are.
Oh,
Mother, Miss Steggles. Yes, I finally appear. Now, what's a disaster? Didn't you just say something was a disaster, Miss Steggles?
Well, I suppose I was saying, and
I do hope you don't take this the wrong way, Mr.
Yes.
Challis. But it just seemed to me that...
Miss Steggles was talking about the bombing of Lamb Cottage, Jerry. Yeah. What a disaster that was.
Oh, disaster. Yes. Oh, yes, that's what I was saying.
Yes. Well, it's certainly a disaster for my peace of mind. Yeah, you've already discussed Cata with Miss Steggles, of course.
Of course.
And?
Jerry, she adored it.
Well, yes. Of course.
It was a strange evening for Margaret. Never had she been so close to Westwood. Yet all the time she was helping, she kept thinking,
if only I had someone who belonged only to me and didn't always have to go into other people's homes and share with them. I want someone for my very own.
Which was how she found herself at 10:30 telephoning Dick.
Hello?
Dick, it's Margaret. I just...
Are you all right? It's quite late.
I'm sorry, I just wondered how Linda was.
She's very well. She's asleep, of course. Are you at your party?
I'm so sorry, Dick, to leave you on your own tonight. I wish I hadn't.
Oh.
I'll come tomorrow, as we agreed. I hope Linda didn't miss me.
Oh, no.
Ah, there you are. Zita needs you.
Dick, I have to go.
All right. See you tomorrow, then.
Yes, although I do...
Oh. I'm so sorry, but when Zita wants something, I find it's the best policy to comply, don't you?
Oh, yes.
And you mustn't let us wear you out, Miss Steggles. It's not as though you work here, is it? And your profession itself is an exhausting one. Do you like teaching?
This was the first time her idol had asked her a question about herself.
I thought I did, but I'm beginning to realise I don't.
Ah, then my advice, Miss Steggles, is get out of it. Oh. At all cost.
But
No, Mother will agree with me.
Will I?
I was just saying to Miss Steggles that she must leave teaching at once if she doesn't love it.
It might not be as easy as all that, Jerry.
No, nonsense. We must never compromise, never settle for the second best. It does untold damage to our souls. I suppose you like Hampstead Heath.
I love it, yes.
You see? You see what's already happening to you.
I spend hours on the heath. I think it's beautiful.
Well, you may like it, my dear, but that does not make it beautiful. Especially not to people who have seen other landscapes that ring and flash with beauty.
Jerry does.
Not everybody can see those landscapes that ring and flash with beauty, Mr. Challis, so they have to make the best of what they can see.
She's right.
No one should accept second best in beauty.
But some people have to.
Never, my child.
Well, yes, they do.
You seem to be lecturing me, Miss Steggles. How thrillingly modern of you.
Some people have to compromise, Mr. Challis. Their whole lives are about compromise. Mine is. That's all it's about, actually. Compromise can be heroic.
Margaret.
Someone like me may have the same ideals and hopes as you, Mr. Challis, and love great art and so on. But in the end, I have to see what choices are really in front of me and choose.
Unsurprisingly, Jerry had no idea what Margaret was talking about. The women he lived with were spoiled and soft. The women he wrote about were so crammed with high-flown integrity that when the first thing threatened their self-worth, they acquired a firearm and did the decent thing with it, often in front of the servants.
Have you private means, Miss Steggles?
Of course I haven't.
Oh, Jerry, what a thing to say.
No, I merely observe that Miss Steggles is the type of woman that needs to ripen in the sun. Do nothing for a few years, let her soul grow. Without money, yes. Yes, it's impossible. Well, I really must spend more time with my other guests, but thank you, Miss Steggles. An entertaining exchange of views. Perhaps you should obtain a soapbox and spend Sunday mornings in Hyde Park.
Margaret, may I call you Margaret?
Yes.
I'm so sorry. Jerry can be very rude.
I can't believe I just spoke like that to him, Lady Challis. Oh, why did I come?
Oh. May I say something? When you spoke of compromise just now, I felt such dread. You're tempted to settle for something, aren't you? You're tempted to marry someone you don't love.
Oh, yes, but it's all right. He won't ask me. He doesn't love me either.
What I'd like you to do is come down by yourself to Martlefield one weekend in the autumn. Then you shall talk and I will listen and try to help you.
Oh, Lady Challis, thank you.
Remind me to tell you about the gentle powers. It will pass, you know, all this turmoil.
I'm so confused, you see.
I do see. But things will settle. It will pass.
Hello?
You're back!
How's Linda?
Not very well. Playing outside.
How's Mrs. Coates?
On the mend, they say.
Looking at Dick as he sat at his dining table with the newspaper open in front of him, she suddenly thought, I don't care what Lady Challis thinks. I wouldn't mind him kissing me. Oh, how confusing this all was for a young, impressionable woman. This playing at being married.
I'll make some tea, shall I?
Good idea. Did you enjoy your party?
Not exactly. I telephoned you, do you remember?
Jolly good. Don't be long, the news will be on in a minute.
But what began as a cosy domestic evening went askew soon after. And Margaret couldn't begin to imagine the cause.
Margaret?
Yes, Dick?
You're very fond of Linda, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Look, Margaret.
What?
Oh, Margaret. You've got to understand, I'm very lonely.
I know, but you're a very good father. No one could be better.
Look, I...
Yes?
He looked at her. She lowered her eyes, smiling. She would say yes. If he asked her, she would say yes.
I...
Yes?
I am... Oh, I'd better walk you to the station.
Oh.
Well, don't just sit there. Here's your coat. We'll have to be quick if I'm leaving Linda on her own. Come on.
Dick?
Don't.
I'm very fond of you, Dick. Whatever it is you wanted to say just then...
Oh. Margaret. You dear girl. You dear, dear girl. There.
Oh, Dick.
There. You should see your face.
Well, I wasn't expecting...
Yes, you were. Look, if you're coming over tomorrow, will you phone me first? At about 6 o'clock?
Well, yes, of course, if you want me to, but why...
That's my girl. 6 o'clock, then.
6 o'clock. Bye-bye.
He loved her. There was no doubt about that now. Marrying Dick would mean giving up her dream of Westwood. It would mean looking after that little house and forgetting about great art. But it would mean love. Love at last. Dick loved her. She was sure she could love him back. She was going to compromise, and it felt all right. How pleased Hilda would be when she knew. The next day, she hardly breathed waiting for 6 o'clock, when she could finally make the call that would change her life.
Oh, Dick, come on.
She thought, This may be the last time I shall see this hall, or that chair, or that staircase, as an unengaged girl. She wondered if everything would look different to her when once the strange transforming words had been said.
Hello. Who is that, please?
May I speak to Mr. Fletcher, please? It's Miss Steggles.
Oh, Miss Steggles! How sweet of you to phone. Was it about coming over this evening? Because I've got some good news for you. I'm back!
Mrs. Coates.
And I'm ever so grateful to you for doing all the dirty work while I was laid up. Dick said he couldn't believe how helpful you were. Never seen anything like it. I worried a young woman like you might, you know, use your feminine wiles on him while my back was turned. But Dick always said, Elsie, she's just not like that. She's the sort of girl you can't imagine has ever been kissed. And Dick and I have got another piece of news for you, too. Guess.
I couldn't possibly.
We're going to be married. Isn't that lovely?
Oh, no. Poor Margaret. What a shock. She had settled for Dick, but he hadn't settled for her.
I'm so glad, Mrs. Coates.
Oh, Elsie, please.
Elsie, then. It'll be lovely for Linda to have...
Oh, look at the time. Already 6 o'clock. I'm afraid I must go and start my hubby-to-be supper. Oh, bye-bye, Margaret. Oh, thanks a million for being such a dear while I was away. Oh, you must come over and see us all very soon.
Yes. I'd like that. Goodbye.
Bye.
Of course, Mother said I told you so.
She actually used those words.
She said I was silly for thinking that just because a lonely man kissed me...
Oh, Mutt.
But why did he kiss me, Hilda? I don't understand. I don't like to think of him as cruel, but wasn't it wicked to kiss me like that when he knew he was going to marry Mrs. Coates?
He kissed you because he wanted to. That's men for you. Any more tea in that pot?
Sorry.
No powers of resistance, either. Mum says they're as weak as water.
Perhaps that's why I adore Mr. Challis so much.
Your playwriter friend?
Yes. But at least he's above all that. He wouldn't fall for somebody just because she had a pretty face. He wouldn't settle for second best.
Of course he wouldn't. And I'm the Queen of Sheba. Are you having that slice?
No, you have it.
Mum says I must have hollow legs.
I've said I'll take the children to Kew Gardens on Saturday.
That Hebe's children? Mark, you are the glutton for punishment.
Well, I thought it would leave the house quiet for Mr. Challis to work. That nice American soldier, Earl, was there when I suggested it. He's going to help me.
Kew Gardens?
Yes, why?
Well, I'm going to Kew Gardens on Saturday, aren't I?
Are you?
Yes! Can you believe it? My Marcus has been pestering me for weeks.
I don't think you'll like it there, Hilda. It's mostly... Well, it's mostly plants.
I don't think I'll like it there either. But I said to him, Marcus, you've gone on about it so much, I'd better go and get it over with.
Saturday was gloriously sunny and warm. It was the sort of day that made Londoners forget the war and think, let's all go to Kew Gardens.
Oh, Daphne, I'm so lucky.
You're telling me? I've put off ever so many things to come to your old queue today. But I meant to tell you, I've got to be back early. I've got a date tonight.
Well, don't you think I might have kept this evening free for me? I've looked forward to this day for months.
And don't I know it? It was about Boxing Day you started dating me up.
Whom will you see this evening? Another man?
One of the crocodiles in the zoo, as a matter of fact. Look, isn't this Hammersmith? Aren't we nearly there?
The brats will be down in a minute. Earl's getting them ready. I do think it's extraordinary of you to take them out for the afternoon, Miss Steggles. I'm blowed if I would. What did you think of Grandma Challis? I bet you loved her.
Oh, I thought she was fascinating.
Well, I suppose she is, in a way, but between you and me, she gets me down.
Does she? Why?
Well, she's a saint. Saints always get you down. 3 days at Martlefield, I start to understand why the Romans were always giving the early Christians the works. Oh, well, here they are. Barnabas, look who's here.
It's Struggles!
No, it's Miss Steggles.
You call her Struggles?
I have no idea where he gets these things. Oh, Earl, are you sure about this?
Oh, it's my pleasure.
All the way to Kew. And let's face it, Barnabas would be just as happy if you put him in the coal bunker for the afternoon.
Oh, God.
I asked Eater to do you a tea basket, but apparently Pops has taken it with him somewhere. Still, one thing less to carry.
Cowie!
Oh, I shouldn't have said that.
Cowie!
Very well.
Whee! A tea basket? I thought it was papers or something.
Have you never seen a tea basket before, you enchanting nymph?
No, I haven't. Oh, what's that?
Ah, the Chinese pagoda. Isn't it a wonderful and exotic effect? The pure Chinese shape seen between those magnificent English trees. England is full of such incongruities. The pavilion at Brighton and... Oh, Daphne, you do look beautiful today.
Marcus, you promised. People will hear you. And what are they going to think of me?
Oh, your hair.
I've got my mum's hair and my dad's feet. We're all so glad it wasn't the other way round.
Oh, this way. Give me your arm.
Wait, what time does your train go?
Oh, Daphne!
The name's Hilda.
Hilda, then. I just want to get you away from all these people.
Fat chance. Oh, look, Marcus, it's a bit quieter over there.
Yes, the Bluebell Wood. Come on!
I had no idea it would be so crowded.
Other people like to have fun on their day off, too, I guess. Hebe doesn't teach the children many manners, does she?
No.
Do you mind me asking, why are you at Westwood so much? Hebe tells everyone you've got a pash on her father, but
a
I don't
pash?
Think... Pash? I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said anything.
No, you shouldn't.
But the thing is, look, Challis is a guy, and, well, everyone knows a guy like that, handsome, successful, he has... You know, girls.
I'm sure Mr. Challis doesn't.
Sure he does. You don't think you're the first one to fall at his feet.
But he has a lovely wife.
Who knows all about his philandering. It's Mrs. Challis who says he's definitely got a girl at the moment.
I can't listen to this.
All the usual signs, she says. She thought it might be you for a month or so.
Oh, no.
But Hebe said no. He never falls for the plain ones. Oh, don't get up, Margaret. I didn't mean that you are plain. I'm sorry. I'm real sorry.
Look, keep an eye on the children, Earl.
Hey, come back.
I just have to... I can't...
Margaret! Damn.
Barnabas! Come here.
Oh, well. This is quite nice, isn't it? Quite secluded. A shame they didn't clear away those dead bluebells, but you can't have everything.
And look, a Shetland rug.
That's handy.
We will have to sit quite close together with the rug being so small.
Well, if I sit here and you sit there, we'll be sitting as far apart as we possibly can then.
The thing about my mum's feet is
Hilda!
Yes, dear?
I love you.
What?
I love you. Oh, give me your hand. I didn't mean to tell you like this. I meant to lead up to it gently, but I can't. You are so beautiful. Your eyes are so unutterably lovely.
Don't get worked up about them. That's my advice.
Don't talk to me like that. Not when I've told you I love you. Don't you realize I want you body and soul? I want to take you away with me to South America.
What?
We could be so happy together. Give me a chance. Oh, Daphne, please don't say no. Imagine us in Rio de Janeiro, in Buenos Aires.
The name's Hilda, as you know perfectly well, and I do say no.
Margaret!
I love you, Hilda!
No, Marcus!
I wrote a West End play about my love for you.
What?
Yes, I did. I wrote a whole play about my love for you, which hundreds of people weep and clap at every night in St. Martin's Lane with matinees on Wednesdays and Saturdays. It's time to tell you that my name is not Marcus. No, it is Gerard Challis. And I'm a very important playwright, and I've loved you, Hilda Wilson, loved you desperately from the moment I first saw you, and oh my God, it's the Steggles girl.
Hilda!
Well, you knew it was coming.
Oh, no!
Hello, Miss Steggles.
Mart, am I glad to see you. Marcus here just went all King Kong on me. Do you know him?
Margaret! Hello, sir. Hello, miss.
This is Hilda Wilson, my best friend. She must be the one you were talking about.
Grandpa!
Oh.
Grandpa, are you pleased to see us?
The explanations at the end of a comedy of errors rarely contain much true entertainment, so we shall skip lightly over them on this occasion. Yes, Hilda, your devoted Marcus is indeed the famous playwright Gerard Challis. He is not only married, but has three grandchildren, two of whom are now tucking into the contents of your tea basket. Yes, Margaret. Oh, poor Margaret. Challis has awful feet of clay. He is quite a silly man, actually. And I can say this, of course, being his mother. In the autumn, Margaret paid me the visit we had talked about. She came with Zita.
Ah, there she is, in the orchard, picking plums.
Oh, it's so lovely here. So peaceful.
Well, I tell you it is, Margaret. Better than your boring old heath.
Can you reach?
I think so. Oh.
You look happier than you did at Westwood.
I am happier, I think. But any special reason? Or just everything?
No. No special reason. Nothing much has happened to me this last year. Except getting to know all of you. And seeing some pictures. And hearing some lovely music.
You're fond of music?
Oh, I like it better than everything except poetry.
There. Now. I'll let this basket down.
Zita! Basket!
Yeah, I have it. Margaret, dear, I need to ask you something. Hebe wants you to look after the children.
Oh. Well, do you think that would be a good thing for me to do?
No, I don't.
Oh, good.
Well, I don't think there are any more plums up here, do you? Shall we go down? Zita seems to have finished. And you know how impatient she can be.
Please, do let's stay up here a little longer. I shan't get a chance to talk to you again. And you said you'd tell me about the gentle powers.
Ah, the gentle powers. Well, it's only my own theory, and don't ever tell Jerry because he believes the opposite. Jerry thinks that our lives are ennobled by suffering, that only misery can make us truly ourselves.
Suffering is the anvil upon which the crystal sword of integrity is hammered.
Oh, did he write that?
Oh, yes. It's famous.
Yes, you'd know it anywhere, wouldn't you? But there are some people who don't need tragedy, Margaret. All that hammering on anvils just wears them out. And it's my belief that they need the gentle powers. Beauty, time, compassion, laughter, friendship, music. Zita needs the gentle powers very much, poor thing, after what she's been through. And you, Margaret, don't need to be plunged into darkness and struggle. Very much the contrary. You need lifting into the light.
Do you think it likely that I shall marry and be loved?
Now, what a thing to ask me. I hope so, my dear. But if you don't, the gentle powers will help you to do the hardest thing in the world.
What is that?
To live without earthly love. Margaret got down from the ladder and stood in the shade of the sighing tree. Nearby, a bonfire of leaves cast a pall of blue smoke, which swirled low and straight about her knees. It was a beautiful day in the season of mists and mellow fruitfulness, just like that other wonderful day 12 months ago, when she found Hebe Nyland's ration book on Hampstead Heath.
I shall never tire of this. I shall love nature and art until I am an old, old woman. And the gentle powers, too.
The Martlefield cob mare was laden with plums. Zita was waiting to lead him to the house.
Margaret, are you ready?
Have I upset you, dear?
No, I think I've always known what you've just told me, but hearing you say it makes me feel free. Does that make sense? But what do I do now?
Now? Mm. Now we've just time to take a load up to the house before lunch.
Zita, is he ready? Margaret, come and help, please. I don't like this beast. I think he hates me. He wants to bite me.
So Margaret left the shade of the tree and went to meet the others and joined them and helped.
In Westwood by Stella Gibbons, Margaret was played by Juliet Aubrey, Challis by Michael Fenton Stevens, Hilda by Saffron Burrows, and Hebe by Caroline Harker. Zita and Mrs. Coates were played by Mia Soterio, Serafina and Kata by Phyllida Nash, and Dick by Jonathan Nibbs. Angela Barlow was Mrs. Steggles, Martin T. Sherman was Earl, and Jacqueline Tong, Granty. Other parts were played by members of the cast. Westwood was adapted for radio by Lynne Truss and narrated by Rosemary Leach. It was produced in Bristol by Kate McCall.